So our next speaker is Justin Milner. Justin carried out his graduate training at the UNC in Chapel Hill in Melina Beck's lab, where he studied the immune response to influenza virus. He was then a postdoctoral fellow in the lab of Ananda Goldratt at UCSD when he studied molecular regulation of CD8 T cells differentiation during infection. Justin recently returned to the UNC Chapel Hill as an assistant professor, where he's starting his own lab. In his free time, Justin likes spending time outdoors with his family. So thank you very much, Justin, for accepting our invitation, and welcome.
Thank you for the introduction. Really excited for this opportunity to present some of the findings from this project, where we were really just trying to understand the heterogeneity of tissue resident memory cells during infection. And as was mentioned, this is work that was carried out during my postdoc in Ananda Goldratt's lab, and I've actually recently started a new lab at UNC, which is in North Carolina. And I'm just going to give a very brief background here, as this was already introduced in the other two talks, but just wanted to set the stage on how we approach this project. So during an acute viral or bacterial infection, antigen-specific CD8 T cells will rapidly expand and differentiate into effector cells that are really critical for mediating pathogen control. And following clearance of the pathogen, a majority of these cells will undergo contraction, and a small population will persist and form long-lived memory T cells. And there's well-described heterogeneity of both the effector phase of infection and memory phase, and we often subset these effector cells into TE, or terminal effector, which tend to be terminally fated or relatively short-lived, as well as memory precursor cells, which preferentially give rise to long-lived memory T cells. And there's also heterogeneity within the memory time points and a number of well-described and characterized populations. Two of the most studied often are effector memory cells and central memory cells. But one problem with this or issue with this differentiation process or model is that it's primarily based on studies of circulating CD8 T cells in the spleen, blood, or lymph node. And a couple years ago, we were really interested in just trying to understand if tissue resident memory cells have a similar differentiation process as well as analogous heterogeneity within individual time points. So to address this question, we use single cell RNA sequencing, and this project was in collaboration with John Chang, Nadia Kurd, and Jean Yeo at UCSD. We use the P14 LC-MV system, which also has been introduced in the other two talks, but just in case anyone recently joined, these are T cell receptor transgenic CD8 T cells that specifically recognize an epitope of the LC-MV pathogen. And these cells are also congenitally distinct, so we can transfer them into recipient mice, infect with LC-MV, and then track them throughout the response to infection. And here we sorted P14 cells from the epithelium of the small intestine, or the IEL compartment, as well as the spleen at various time points post-infection. And first, just showing the results for the splenic populations. And you can see there's a kind of a progression in the clusters. So in red is day 4, blue is day 7, and out and to the left are later infection time points. And our first question, still restricting our analysis to the splenic populations, was just which of these cells are enriched with a signature effector, effector gene expression signature. And we find that, as you might expect, at day 7, these cells were highly enriched with an effector gene program, but at the later infection time points, were more enriched with a memory gene expression signature. And there's also heterogeneity within individual time points. And so here, looking at day 10, there are populations of cells enriched with an effector program. And then within the same time point, there are cells enriched with a memory gene signature. So this seems to be consistent with this differentiation model. But we were really interested in asking this question, but in the context of the IEL populations. And so we see a similar progression in the clusters. So day 4 here, moving down to the left, later memory time points. And we also see enrichment of this effector gene signature at early infection time points in the intestine, and enrichment of the memory gene program at later time points in the intestine. And we also noted heterogeneity within individual time points. So here, looking at day 7 and day 10 time points, where there are cells enriched with an effector program, but also cells enriched with a memory program. And so even though it may not seem that surprising that at early time points in the intestine, IEL cells can be more effector-like and at later time points are more memory-like, but we think this information was useful because it allows us to begin considering PRM differentiation and heterogeneity in sort of this similar framework in which we think about circulating CD8 cells. And there are a number of processes that are well known to regulate these divergent effector and memory-like states. And single-cell RNA-seq is really useful in sort of probing or assessing a number of these features, but we were really interested in determining if we could identify transcription factors that not only delineate distinct populations of TRM cells, but that also functionally regulate the heterogeneity of TRM. And so using our single-cell RNA-seq data, we focused on an early infection time point, as well as a later infection time point. And we found interesting expression patterns for a number of transcription factors that control these states, but we were particularly interested in PRDM1, which encodes the transcription factor BLIMP1, as well as ID3. And we found interesting expression patterns where PRDM1 seemed to decrease over time in the intestine, and ID3 seemed to be upregulated. And we also noted heterogeneity within individual time points looking at these factors. And then in addition, we were interested in these molecules because there's existing evidence that they have key regulatory roles in T cell differentiation. And so work by Laura McKay and colleagues demonstrated that BLIMP1 is really crucial for TRM formation in diverse non-lymphoid tissues. And additionally, other work has shown that ID3 is important for the formation of long-lived circulating memory T cells, and that BLIMP1 can actually suppress ID3 expression and limit the formation of these circulating memory cells. So given the interesting expression patterns from our single cell data, as well as previous literature, we next just followed up on BLIMP1 and ID3 expression levels during LCMV infection. And here we used BLIMP1 YFP P14 mice, as well as ID3 GFP P14 mice. And we use these reporters because ID3 and BLIMP1 are actually fairly tricky to stain for flow cytometry, at least in CD8 T cells. So using these reporter mice, and first looking at BLIMP1 YFP expression levels, you can see here that at day 7 of infection, so this would be an effector time point, that nearly 75% of all the IEL cells were BLIMP1 high. And the frequency of BLIMP1 expressing cells decreases over time. So by day 30, only roughly about 20% of the cells were BLIMP1 high. And this decrease in BLIMP1 expression is consistent with what was shown in skin TRM. And then if we look at ID3 expression levels here, at day 7, we detected very few ID3 high cells, about 2%. But about 1 month after infection, nearly half of all the TRM cells in the epithelium were ID3 high. So it seemed that BLIMP1 and ID3 sort of have this reciprocal expression pattern where BLIMP1 decreases over time in IEL cells, whereas ID3 increases over time. And this expression pattern was also reflected in the single cell RNA-seq data. And next, just to follow up on the ID3 and BLIMP1 populations a bit more, we crossed the ID3 reporter mice with BLIMP1 YFP mice and to generate these double reporter mice. And the reason we did that is we were interested in determining if ID3 and BLIMP1 expression, or ID3 and BLIMP1 can be co-expressed, or if their expression is segregated to distinct populations of cells. And then we were also interested in determining if ID3 high and BLIMP1 high populations were actually functionally distinct subsets of IEL cells. And here, using the double reporter mice and looking in the intestine at day 5, we find that a majority of the IEL cells at this early time point were BLIMP1 high, whereas we did not detect any of the ID3 high population here at day 5. But as over the course of the infection and into later memory time points, the frequency of BLIMP1 high cells decreases, whereas the frequency of ID3 high cells increases. And this pattern was similar to what we saw on the previous slide using the single reporters. And then one interesting thing to note is that this increase in the frequency of these ID3 high cells seem to be unique to either TRM or at least the intestine, because we didn't detect a similar increase in the lymph node or the spleen. So we next evaluated other non-lymphoid sites. So here again, looking in the small intestine, so IEL or the epithelium, as well as the lamina propria. And in both of these compartments, we see an ID3 high population of cells, and this is 90 days post-infection. But when we profiled the brain, white adipose tissue, salivary gland, and the kidney, and actually found little to no ID3 high expressing cells in these tissues. And then we also tested in an intranasal infection model, we found minimal to no ID3 expression in lung TRM, but we did detect an ID3 high population in epidermal TRM. So it seems that there's something interesting about or unique about the skin and the small intestine that allows upregulation or expansion of this ID3 high population. And then last, we also validated these results in a distinct infection system. So we used a localized enteric listeria infection, and we saw similar expression dynamics of LIMP1 and ID3 in this model. And next, just further comparing the LIMP1 high and ID3 high populations. So first, just looking transcriptionally, how distinct are these cells? And so we sorted LIMP high and ID3 high cells at an effector time point, as well as a memory time point for RNA-seq analysis. And here on the y-axis, this is a LIMP1 high TRM. And we pretty quickly noted elevated expression levels of more effector-like transcripts. So CD11B, KLRG1, TIM3, as well as granzymes. And then in the day 35 ID3 high TRM population, there were elevated levels of more memory-like transcripts such as TCS7, SLAMF6, and BOC2. And we were also interested in comparing the relationship of LIMP1 high and ID3 high TRM with other existing well-known subsets of CD8 T cells or CD4 cells. So we generated gene signatures for TCM and TEM, as well as MPTE and TFH and TH1. And we found that the ID3 high TRM population was more enriched with a TCM gene expression signature, MP, and TFH. And in thinking a bit more about the relationship between these subsets in general, TCM, MP, and TFH tend to be more memory-like or possibly more multipotent, whereas these populations tend to be more terminally fated or effector-like. And so, at least transcriptionally, it seems that the ID3 high TRM can be placed on this side of the spectrum where they tend to have more memory-like features, and LIMP1 high TRM appear to be more effector-like. And then returning to the single cell RNA-seq data, we generated an ID3 high TRM gene expression signature and just asked which cells in this data set are enriched with our ID3 high signature. And we actually found that cells at later infection time points were more enriched with this ID3 TRM gene program, whereas at early effector time points, the cells were highly enriched with a more effector IL program from the BLIMP high cells. And then further, just to compare the function of these distinct populations, we next assessed the production of TNF-alpha and interferon gamma from ID3 high and BLIMP high TRM following peptide restimulation. And we found a greater frequency of ID3 high cells were capable of TNF-alpha production as well as IL-2, but the BLIMP high population produced dramatically elevated levels of granzyme B, which seemed to be consistent with this more terminal or effector phenotype of the BLIMP high cells. And then next, to assess the memory potential of these populations, we did this through a sort retransfer experiment where ID3 high TRM from the small intestine and BLIMP high TRM from the small intestine were sorted and retransferred into recipient mice. And then we infected these recipients with LCMB. And then about a month after this infection, we profiled the donor cells in the intestine and the spleen. And we actually found that there was a greater frequency of ID3 high donor cells in both the spleen and the intestine. And these ID3 high donors had a more memory-like phenotype in the spleen. So this did seem to indicate that these ID3 high cells may actually have greater memory potential because they had a greater ability to give rise to both circulating memory cells in the spleen as well as tissue-resident memory cells in the intestine. So it seems that BLIMP1 high and ID3 high TRM populations are transcriptionally and in some ways functionally distinct. And so in addition to characterizing these populations at a memory time point, we also wanted to determine if ID3 and BLIMP1 expression levels can help clarify or explain some of the heterogeneity at the effector phase of infection. So here we sorted BLIMP high and ID3 high populations at a day 7 time point for RNA-seq analysis. And similar to what we observed during the memory time point, the ID3 high IL cells had elevated expression levels of more memory-like transcripts such as BCL6, TCF7, and SLAMF6, and also interestingly P2RX7. But the BLIMP high IL cells had elevated levels of more effector transcripts, also consistent with memory time points such as TIM3, CX3CR1, CD11B, as well as granzymes. And just following up on this phenotype a bit more, In red here, you can see that the blimp high IL cells have elevated expression levels of KLG1 and CD11B. But one interesting phenotype that we noticed was that the ID3 high IL cells more rapidly upregulated CD69 and CD103. Another way to visualize this is in this representative flow plot, where we found that about 75% of all the ID3 high cells at day 7 of infection had already upregulated CD69 and CD103. So given the more memory-like gene expression profile, as well as the rapid adoption of a TRM phenotype, it seems that ID3 could be useful in delineating TRM precursors. And these findings are consistent with other reports demonstrating that KLRG1 low cells in non-lymphoid tissues more rapidly upregulate CD103 than KLRG1 high cells. And just returning to this model, so we were originally interested in really clarifying the heterogeneity of TRM cells and determining if there's sort of an analogous relationship with how circulating CD8 T cells differentiate and TRM cells differentiate. And we found that BLIMP1 high cells, either at a memory time point or an effector time point, were at least transcriptionally more effector-like, and ID3 high cells tended to be more memory-like at both time points. And in some data that I didn't show, it seems that combined activity of ID2 and ID3 is really critical for the formation or the maintenance, actually, of this ID3 high, more memory-like TRM population, whereas BLIMP1 and TBET are really critical for the more terminal effector IL subset that express elevated levels of BLIMP1. And then the last portion of this project kind of transitioned into looking at TRM-like cells in the tumor microenvironment. And a number of recent studies have highlighted that certain CD8 T cells within solid tumors can exhibit features of TRM. And this has been linked to a protective outcome or improved prognoses for different types of malignancies, such as breast cancer and lung cancer. And in a previous study, we observed a similar finding where we generated a core tissue residency signature that consisted of 121 genes from upregulated in TRM from 5 non-lymphoid tissues. And when we look at the expression levels of this residency signature in tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes and mouse melanoma tumors, we found that a majority of this core residency signature was upregulated in T cells within tumors compared to tumor-specific T cells in the spleen. And I think the idea is that having a TRM program could be important in facilitating T cell retention, prolonged survival and persistence, as well as sustained function in solid tumors, which in many ways actually resemble non-lymphoid sites. And so given this protective role of TRM in tumors, we next just wanted to evaluate if we can identify BLIMP1 high and ID3 high TRM-like populations as well. And here we use single cell RNA sequencing to address this question. And we have a mouse melanoma cell line that stably expresses the GP33 epitope, which can be recognized by these P14 cells. So we transplant the cell line subcutaneously, and then about a week after tumors are established, we transfer in our P14 cells, which function as tumor-specific T cells in this model. And then about 1 week after adoptive transfer, we sort the P14 cells for single cell RNA-seq. And our first question was just, can we find any of these P14 cells in the tumor that are enriched with an ID3 high TRM gene expression signature? And the cells in orange are enriched with this signature, and so we found fairly broad and variable enrichment, but we did detect this sort of cluster on the left here highlighted with this red circle that was enriched with the ID3 high TRM signature and also depleted of the BLIMP high signature. And if we look a bit closer in this cluster, these cells express elevated levels of TCF7 and SLAMF6 and lower levels of granzyme and TIM3. And so this seemed to be consistent with what we were seeing transcriptionally in the intestine during infection. So we followed up with our double reporter mice, and about 7 days after adoptive transfer, we found that a third of all TIL were BLIMP1 high, whereas about 5 to 15% of the cells were ID3 high. And transcriptionally, the ID3 high TIL have elevated levels of more memory-like transcripts, such as SLAMF6, BCL6, and TCF7, whereas the BLIMP high TIL express elevated levels of more effector transcripts, so KLRG1 and granzyme B and TIM3. And these ID3 high TIL, so the P14 cells in the tumor, were enriched with an ID3 high TRM gene expression signature. And conversely, the BLIMP high TIL in the tumor were also enriched with a BLIMP high gene expression signature. And this gene expression profile was reminiscent of some recently described subsets of exhausted CD8 T cells within tumors called progenitor exhausted and terminally exhausted cells. And terminally exhausted cells tend to be more terminally faded or effector-like and can be delineated by expression of TIM3 or granzyme B, whereas progenitor exhausted cells are more memory-like or even more multipotent and express high levels of SLAMF6 and TCF1. And to further evaluate the progenitor exhausted populations in the context of ID3 and BLIMP1, we, using our double reporter mice, we found that the BLIMP high cells tended to be TIM3 high, SLAMF6 low, whereas the ID3 high cells were SLAMF6 high, TIM3 low. So it seemed that ID3 and BLIMP1 can also be useful in distinguishing these distinct subsets exhausted populations within tumors. And then last, just to try and integrate the data from the last few slides, looking at T cell populations in tumors, we next assess how BLIMP1 deficiency can actually impact the differentiation and accumulation of T cells within tumors. And we found that BLIMP1 deficient cells in the spleen or the lymph node, there was no impact on the accumulation of these cells. So BLIMP1 wasn't essential for optimal accumulation of cells in either the lymph node or the spleen. But we did find that with BLIMP1 deficiency, there was a pretty dramatic loss of tumor-specific cells. And then assessing the phenotype, we also found that BLIMP1 was important for optimal formation of these more terminally exhausted cells compared to the progenitor exhausted population. So it seems that BLIMP1 is either supporting a terminally exhausted program or maybe suppressing a progenitor exhausted program, but this is consistent with a previously reported role for BLIMP1 in chronic viral infection. And then, as it's known that BLIMP1 is really crucial for promoting a tissue residency gene program, this may partially explain why we see this tumor-specific loss of P14 cells when we lose BLIMP1 activity. And just a quick summary, so using single-cell RNA-seq and various reporter mice, we found that IL cells exhibit functional heterogeneity. And in thinking about the relationship of these BLIMP1 high more effector-like cells and the ID3 high more memory-like TRN population, this may be a division of labor where the BLIMP high cells are really critical for rapid effector function in the intestine upon reinfection, whereas this ID3 high population is really critical for more sustained or flexible immune response. And then one thing I just wanted to point out is we focused pretty heavily on comparing how circulating memory CD T cells differentiate with how resident cells differentiate. But I think it's important to note that TRM are really transcriptionally and phenotypically distinct from circulating cells. And so there are likely a number of other differences that regulate the differentiation of circulating resident populations that we haven't really looked into in this study. And I think this can be partially highlighted in this PCA plot where we show that the ID3 high IL cells are transcriptionally distinct from other IEL populations, but they're also distinct from ID3 cells in the spleen. And then also we focus pretty heavily on TRM heterogeneity in terms of effector and memory-like states, but there are a number of other aspects to TRM heterogeneity that we also haven't really dug into in this study. And I'll just point out that John Chang's recent work does a great job of really further characterizing TRM heterogeneity. And then last, we found that BLIMP1 is important in supporting a terminally exhausted phenotype and seems to be essential for the optimal accumulation of T cells in tumors. And so consistent with other recent reports, it seems that it might be useful to consider tissue residency features of T cells in addition to the exhausted state when we're optimizing T cell responses for cancer. And then I just wanted to give a quick snapshot of what my lab will be working on. So we're really interested in understanding the transcriptional and epigenetic signals that control T cell differentiation in the tumor microenvironment, and also understanding or identifying factors that regulate the accumulation, persistence, and function of T cells in tumors, such as having a tissue residency program. And then I'd just like to thank everyone in the Goldrath lab, especially Ananda, who is a really excellent mentor. And I worked really closely with Kyla Malusik and Clara Toma on this project, so special thanks to them. And just like to acknowledge our collaborators, John Chang and Nadia Kurd, as well as Case Muir and Arthur in the Muir lab, who's a huge help with a lot of the computational analysis. And thank you all for listening. I really appreciate it and happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Justin, for this incredible presentation. So actually, we have a couple of questions in the chat, if you could go through them.
Okay. Based on the changes in ID3 versus BLIMP1 populations over time, is the quality of secondary TRM responses in the gut distinct at early time, at early memory, if compared to late memory, i.e. differences in cytokine production, recruitment of circulating immune cells, interstitially? I don't know if the quality would be different, but the response would be different. So the further you go into later memory time points, you're gonna have a greater frequency of ID3 high cells. And we think those are essential for really helping to mount an effective secondary response by giving rise to rapid proliferation and also recruiting new populations to the site of infection. But the BLIMP high cells may be really critical for rapid killing. So I think if you wait later, you might see more of a delay in the initial titer if you re-challenge with the virus. But great question. Okay, another question. Are the ID2 cells giving rise to the BLIMP ones? Are the ID2 cells giving rise to the BLIMP ones in the TIL compartment? If so, how connect with the fact that BLIMP ones go down over time upon LCD infection? Okay, so I think this is meant to be ID3, but we don't think that the ID3 high cells are giving rise to the BLIMP ones in the TIL compartment. I think that the BLIMP high cells are kind of terminally fixed in that compartment or in that phenotype and actually probably arise from the BLIMP low, ID3 low population. If so, how does it connect with the fact that BLIMP ones go down over time? I'm not sure what that second point means, but we do know that BLIMP1 high and ID3 high populations just have a different expression levels of factors that regulate homeostasis and survival. So that may partially explain that second question.
Yeah, sorry to interrupt. That was my question. What I meant in the second part, sorry to interrupt. I meant ID3 in the TIL compartment. I mean, because if you made a comparison of the ID3 positive population and the population of progenitors, so theoretically the progenitor population could give rise to the BLIMP1, but at the same time, if you look at LCMV infection, you have a majority of BLIMP1 positive cells at first, and those wane over time, wane over time. It was probably due to either cell death or they're migrating out of the tissue. We don't know. So my point is that it looks like you have two different circumstances, one in the TIL where you have both populations arising at the same time, one of the guts where one population arises first and the other. But you mentioned about the double negative population, so I think that they helped a lot answering the question.
Great question. Yeah, we spent a lot of time trying to figure out the best way to really determine the lineage of those distinct populations. So if we could transfer a low IL population and put it directly into the epithelium of the gut or something like that, but some of those experiments were just a little too tricky, and so we ended up not going down that route, but I think it's an interesting question.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Do you see any differences in tumor growth comparing mice that received P14 versus BLIMP1 knockdown P14? So we didn't test the efficacy of BLIMP1 knockdown, but my guess is that without BLIMP, you would have less control over tumor growth and how that responds to. So that's an interesting question because, the question was, if we knock down BLIMP1, how will that affect responsiveness to anti-PD-1? And that's a good question because when you knock down BLIMP, you get a greater frequency of these progenitor exhausted cells, which we know tend to be more responsive to immunotherapies such as anti-PD-L1. But we also know that BLIMP1 is required for that more terminal effector population, and that's been shown to be really critical for killing tumors. So the terminally exhausted cells express really high levels of granzyme B, and it's been shown in ex vivo killing studies to have greater killing capacity than the progenitor exhausted. So you actually need both progenitor and terminally exhausted subsets. So I think if you knock down BLIMP1, there might be a rapid, an early quick response to anti-PD-L1, but I don't think you would see dramatic differences in tumor size. Okay, do you know if a cell that was originally BLIMP1 positive can become ID3 positive? Did you try fade mapping experiments? Yeah, great question. We spent a lot of time trying to figure out a way we could do this other than just creating an entire new line of mice. So to answer this question, we basically can just draw comparisons for what happens with circulating cells. And it seems that when you what we've actually done these studies is if you transfer a terminally differentiated or the most terminal population of circulating memory cells and transfer them to the new mice, none of them give rise to TCM, which could be the analogous population to the ID3 subset. So at least in LCMV, we don't think that the that blimp high cells can become ID3. So good question. Okay, have you been able to explore any of this heterogeneity by multiplex IHC? Have any favorite markers to differentiate the populations? Yeah, also interesting question. We also want to determine why this would be interesting is if to see if the ID3 high cells actually have different localization patterns within the non-lymphoid tissue or the tumor. So we haven't done that. And then favorite markers. Yeah, so there are a number of genes that kind of keep coming up that are consistent with ID3 expression or BLIMP1. And you've mentioned a few of them. So TCF7 seems to typically come up in the ID3 high population, whether it's infection or cancer, and CD39 tends to be upregulated in the BLIMP high cells. But granzyme and TIM3 also mark the BLIMP high population. And then BCL6 is often also upregulated in ID3 high cells. Okay, I think that's all the questions.
So thank you very much, Justin. I have just one more question. Yeah. It might be really naive. So I was looking at the data that ID3 actually have like more CD5 expression. So I don't know if these ID3 positive require more TCR signaling or not.
Yeah, that's a good question. We were kind of confused by that as well. I was expecting CD5 to be up higher on the BLIMP high population. Mm-hmm. So to be honest, I don't know if there's a difference there, but definitely something interesting to follow up. Good question.
Okay, so thank you very much, all of the audience and all of the speakers for being here. So if we could take a picture of